You asked me to sort of introduce myself. I'm a psychologist by training. I then moved to the Institute of Psychiatry and worked with Professor Andrew Pickles, who was originally a geographer and is now one of the leading epidemiologists in our field, as well as Barbara Morn, who was originally someone who graduated in English and then became a social worker and then became one of the leading developmental psychopathologists in the world. So that was sort of my training in this field. Since then, in 2009, I moved to Cardiff University and sort of joined a fantastic group of academics and clinicians led by Professor Anita Thapper there. And a lot of the material I'm going to be presenting today, most of the material I'm presenting, is actually a reflection of the hard work and the skills of that group there with, you know, and I'll highlight some bits which are my own input. And one of the really nice things about working within that group at Cardiff is how interdisciplinary, how collaborative it is. We have weekly meetings where all of us, clinicians, trainees, academics, all pitch in together, chew over the material, so it really is a collaborative piece of work. So that's all by way of introduction. In terms of the presentation, I've got about 45 minutes of material. I try and pace it reasonably so, and if necessary, cut bits out to keep within the time. Perhaps what we could do is, if there are, because it's quite a lot of material, if there's sort of clarificational questions about particular bits of the study, perhaps I can take those as, you know, key points as we go through, but maybe leave the broader discussion until we get to the end, if that feels good to everyone. Okay? So this study is... So this research I'm going to present is, the title, as you can see, is Risk and Resilience in Adolescent Offspring of Parents with Depression. And this is the outline of my talk. I'm going to present some background and some aims for the study. I'm going to talk about the sample, the methodology of the early prediction of adolescent depression study. Talk about predictors of new onset depression and risk mechanisms. And really raise, sort of draw some attention to the question of direction of effects. And one of the real issues that I think people tend to forget in our field, even those who are working within our field, is we often think about influences of parents on children. And actually we need to be thinking about family processes, transactional effects, influences of children on parents as well. So I won't say much about that, but I will draw some attention to that issue. And then I'm going to finish off by talking about resilience and really drawing attention to the fact that, again, as a group, children of depressed parents are at increased risk for a whole host of different problems. Actually, this group shows a wide variety of outcomes. Some children do remarkably well and don't have problems, mental health problems, and show positive outcomes in a whole number of ways. And understanding that, I think, is just as important for prevention and intervention as understanding risk mechanisms. Okay, so depression in young people, some basic sort of facts about depression as a disorder. Adolescence is a really important period in terms of understanding the life course of depression. Prior to puberty, rates of depressive disorder are very low in children, although they do occur, but they have quite a different etiology, quite a different pattern, epidemiological pattern. So, for example, they're just as common in prepubertal children in boys as in girls. But once you get to adolescence, once you get past puberty, you see the development of the typical pattern of depressive disorders in the population. So an increase in rates of depression, but particularly so in girls, in females. The etiology, the etiological risk factors for depression become like those that you see in adulthood once you reach adolescence. And the peak incidence of depressive disorder is in adolescence and then in early adulthood. As importantly, if we look at the prognosis and the impact of depression in adolescence and adults, where depression starts in adolescence, it has a particularly pernicious course. The prognosis is poorer, the impact on functioning is worse than when it starts in adulthood. So clearly, the view that moodiness, sort of tearfulness, fluctuations in mood are common, you know, a normative feature of adolescence, and children grow out of those is not true. When we look from a psychiatric sense, if we look at depressive disorders, they're important to prevent occurring in adolescence. And there's actually now a clinical view that even if we could just delay the onset of depression until teenagers get past school, get into adulthood, we'll end up with a better prognosis than if they kick in adolescence. Most teenagers with depression, most adolescents with depression, receive no intervention. They're not picked up by services, they're not picked up by doctors, often they're not even picked up as being depressed by their own families or by themselves. So most receive no intervention, and prevention is really pretty much non-existent apart from in academic trials. One of the best established risk factors for depression in young people is having a parent with depression. Sorry, am I standing in front of the slides?
You are a bit.
Okay. Would it help if I moved over here for everyone?
No.
That's okay.
Is this better?
To that side of that chair.
Right. So, just the final point on here to make is that the best established risk factor for young people developing depression is having a parent with depression. And that's important for two reasons, because parental depression is actually very common. Around 2 million children in the UK will at some stage in their lives experience depression in their parents. It's also one of the most, in terms of effect size, the odds ratio for developing depression yourself if your parent is depressed is around 3 to 4 in many studies. And where parental depression is more severe or recurrent, that risk is increased even further. Okay, so I won't say much more about what's on here, I've already covered a lot of that, but the final point I wanted to make is that the outcomes for children of parents with depression from previous research suggest that, first of all, we shouldn't just think about depression in young people. Actually, risks for a whole host of other forms of psychopathology are increased. Anxiety problems, behavioural problems, substance use, suicidality, and so forth. And also, that problems in children of depressed parents aren't inevitable. In all the studies that have been done to date, and they're relatively limited, even those followed to adulthood, they're usually a subgroup of children of depressed parents who do remarkably well, who don't develop problems of any sort. So the key questions are, can we predict within this higher risk group who are a subgroup who are most at risk? Can we predict early on, before disorders start, who will develop depression, who will develop other forms of mental health problems? Because if we can predict that, we can identify those who are most likely to benefit from preventative interventions. What are the key risk mechanisms that explain the intergenerational transmission of risk from parents to children? I've already mentioned child effects on parents, and an important part of that, are there child effects on parents' illness course in terms of their own depression? And then finally, what accounts for resilience? So this is the study. The study was set up before I arrived in Cardiff. It's a study of parents and children recruited mainly from primary care, so from GPs. And within Cardiff and South Wales, our study team managed to recruit quite a large number. I think it was over 60 or 70 GP surgeries, all of whom were happy to help with recruitment into the study, which I think was a major accomplishment. To begin with, if we think about how busy GPs are in their everyday life, to interest them in this research, to get them to commit to it, and to provide support for it. So the sample consists largely of parents whose depression is known to services, is known to doctors. We excluded parents with bipolar disorder, so the focus here is on unipolar depression. And we started then in 2007 with a baseline with a sample of just over 300 index parents, all of whom had experienced multiple episodes of depressive disorder.
Just a point of clarification, on that slide you're using mothers and parents. Are you talking about fathers as well in this slide?
Yes, so the reason I've got mothers on here is because I think it's important to highlight that the sample wasn't restricted to mothers. But in the event, actually the way that the recruitment went, the vast majority of the sample, the index parents are mothers. So in some of the later slides, we restricted our analyses just to those, just to the 315 who were mothers, just to ease interpretation. But the study's not set up to, so what we can't do is we can't unpick whether the effects of paternal depression are different from those of maternal depression.
Did you distinguish between parents who were depressed at the time the children were depressed, or was parents that had depression at any time in their life?
I'll come on to that. All of the children in the study lived with the affected parent at the time of recruitment, and there were a small handful of children where the episodes of depression of the parent predated their birth. And most of the analyses, and I'm not going to talk about those results, we reran them just excluding that subset. So on by and large, all of the children in the sample have experienced depression in their parents at some stage. But you'll see that, as I'll talk about a bit more in a minute, there's variation in the recurrence over the study period. So for some, it will be a kind of a developmental risk factor. For others, it will be a proximal risk factor during the time of the study. And we did look at that. Okay, so just the last thing to say here about the sample is we wanted to... The aim of the study was to track, was to try and predict new onset depressive disorders. And so it was trying to get in, sort of take, do a baseline assessment at a time, just at the start of adolescence, and to see which of the young people would become depressed. So we wanted to see whether we could predict, rather than just assess correlates of depression in the young people. So for that reason, the inclusion criteria, whilst it covered a broad age range of 9 to 17, the selection was that where there were multiple children in the family, it was the youngest child who was recruited into the study. So at baseline, the mean age of the sample is around 12 years, and I'll talk about what we did then. So at baseline, so it's a three-wave longitudinal study with roughly a 16-month interval between baseline and first follow-up, and then another year between the second and the third wave study. And at each wave of assessment, we undertook multi-method, multi-informed assessments of the sample, of the index parent, of the child, and also, to some degree, of the co-parent, where there was a co-parent in the family. And all of the assessments, pretty much all of the assessments that we included in the study were repeated on each occasion, which allows us, which is a real strength of the study, because we can do all sorts of longitudinal modelling that we couldn't if we just had measures or different measures on different occasions. Today I'm going to focus on the clinical, the cognitive and the psychosocial elements of the assessments. We did also undertake, one of the collaborators on the study is a GP, so he was interested in blood pressures and cortisols and various sort of things I know relatively little about, markers of infection and immunity. We also took blood samples so we could look at DNA. I'm not going to talk about those assessments today, so I'm going to focus on the phenotypic side. In terms of procedures, at each wave of assessment, pairs of interviews, so research psychologists who were trained in the assessments went out to the homes of the study members and separately undertook interviews with the index parents and the study child. The parents, the co-parents and the children all completed a big battery of questionnaires. There was a neurocognitive test assessment with the study child, and then all of that process was supervised through weekly supervision meetings with two consultant psychiatrists who oversaw not just the quality of the process, the research process, but also made sure that where there was where people were unsure about the diagnoses within the clinical interviews, we had clinical consensus meetings to chew over those. And perhaps the most important person in this study, and I think this is a real lesson to anyone who's engaged in this kind of research, was a nurse who's not a researcher, who was a research administrator. And if she wasn't working for us, I'm pretty sure she'd work for FBI or MI5 or something like that. And she, it was her manner, it was her persistence, which meant her job was to track people down, find where they were, give them a call, get in touch with them, interest them in the research, and keep them engaged in the research. And if you look at the response rates we got around 85% at follow-up, at both follow-ups. And that's pretty remarkable for a clinical study. So that's just one thing to say about that. Okay, so this is what the sample looks like in terms of its demographics. As I mentioned, it's a South Wales sample. It's not a particularly disadvantaged sample. So around 70% of the sample were two-parent families. We had some low-income families, but not the majority, around 30% who had incomes below £20,000 per annum. It's not particularly, so that the mean age of parents at baseline was 41 years old, and if you work that backwards, that means at the birth of their child, they were probably in their early to mid-20s. So again, we're not thinking this is a particularly disadvantaged sample in that sense. And children's IQ, where they were slightly lower than you would expect, but not markedly so. So average IQ is around 95. Okay, so this is just an overview of the assessments we undertook, and I'm not going to talk through these in great detail, just in the interest of time, but we had to assess child psychopathology, we used the CAPA, which is an instrument, an interview developed by Jane Costello and Adrian Angold in the States. It's a semi-structured interview where you ask questions about each of the symptoms that make up the various DSM-4 child psychiatric disorders. In addition to the symptoms, you also ask about impairment associated with those symptoms. So it's got a very high threshold for rating a symptom as present. So for example, if we asked about suicidality, we'd ask them we wouldn't just be asking, have you ever thought of death, have you ever thought about killing yourself? The threshold would be something like, do your thoughts about death, about killing yourself, do you think about them most of the day? Do they impact, do they affect how you can concentrate at school? So when we're talking about symptoms and psychopathology, according to this assessment, it's a very conservative estimate, in my view. Now, I'm not a clinician and I didn't administer the interview, so perhaps I'm wrong, but that's what people have told me about. So we have ratings of disorder of each of the different disorders at each wave, with the parent, both parent and child information used to derive those. We also have behaviour and mood symptom totals. And just to say in terms of terminology, when I talk about mood, what I mean is depressive disorders. When I talk about behaviour, I mean conduct disorder or oppositional defiant disorder. But I'm just going to refer to those for simplicity here. In terms of the parent, so the index parent, the first thing that we wanted to do in the study was to make sure that the GP had got it right, that they really were depressed and that their antidepressants prescriptions, their working diagnoses were justified. So based on we confirmed that they really had met criteria, research criteria, for multiple depressive episodes. We checked that they didn't have bipolar disorder. And then at each wave of assessment, we asked about depression again using the scan interview, which allowed us to see whether they had more episodes since the start of the study. And we also included a historical assessment of depression throughout their lifetime. So we found out about age of onset, periods of depression in the antenatal period, number of overall episodes, and severity of the worst two episodes using the global assessment of functioning scale and asking about hospitalization for depression. We also asked the parents to report on family history, so we found out whether other relatives had suffered from depression. And together, that assessment provides quite a good picture of the overall variations in severity within our sample in terms of depression risk. And then finally, there's a whole load of symptom screens which we use for some of our analyses, but I'm not going to talk through in detail. But they're well-validated assessments, like the strength and difficulties questionnaire for children, the HADS, which assesses anxiety, or the ORDID, which assesses problem drinking. I'm not going to talk about each of the measures in terms of our predictive factors, our risk factors, our mechanisms, but these are the kinds of constructs we were interested in. So we were interested in family functioning, we were interested in things like parental warmth and hostility. We assessed that using both questionnaires, but also expressed emotion, so where we got parents to talk about their children and rated the quality, the content, and the tone of that speech sample. We asked about the parental relationship with each other, sibling relationships, and also whether, and I think this is really important from a sort of, we hypothesized that where one parent is depressed and may be more unavailable to children in terms of providing emotional support, that the co-parent plays a particularly important role. So we asked about emotional support to the child that the co-parent provides. And we asked children that. We asked about children's social relationships, sorry.
Were there any families where both parents were depressed?
We didn't systematically ask, do the full psychiatric interviews with a co-parent. We did have measures of symptom screen measures of depressive symptoms in the co-parent. So using the Beck's depression inventory. So I'll come back to that. So we also had measures of social relationships, peer relationships, friendships, whether children, teenagers, young people were going out to social clubs and undertaking extracurricular activities outside the home. Measures of health behaviours, things like undertaking frequent exercise. So NICE guidelines suggest that if you're more active, you're less likely to become depressed, you're more likely to get better quicker. So we were interested in that, whether that's true. And then a colleague of mine, Francis Rice, led on a sub-study of cognition. And from wave two onwards, wave two and wave three, got funding to include a whole much more detailed, more experimental tasks of neurocognition, of executive functioning, reward processing, questionnaires around coping styles and attitudes and so forth. Okay, so these are skipping forward to some results from the study. This is the sort of basic picture of psychopathology if you look longitudinally across the three waves, with around 40% of young people meeting these quite stringent criteria for DSM psychiatric disorder on at least one occasion. Even though where young people didn't have disorders, actually, if we soften that threshold a bit and look at sub-threshold symptoms of depression or behaviour disorders, we found that between 45 and 70% had three or more symptoms of depression or three or more symptoms of conduct disorder. And over a quarter at some point expressed serious suicidal ideation or reported self-harm. So in sum, it's a very high-risk group when you compare that to rates in the general population. So, for example, in the sort of British population norms, the ONS BCAM studies, the typical figure that you find in terms of cross-sectional estimates of prevalence is around 10% for psychiatric disorder. So it's four times higher in this study. So in terms of questions, can we predict who will develop depression and other psychopathology, and what are the risk mechanisms? So for this, I want to talk through three blocks of conceptual factors. Factors related to parents' own illness, so parents' own depression, factors related to family processes, and then cognitive factors. And I'll start with just summarising actually what the main findings were and then talk briefly, so provide some evidence for each of those. And the main things that predicted psychopathology, just to say this is important because when a parent presents to services, as all of these parents did, the doctor there, the GP, has an opportunity to identify potentially those young people, those children who are at most at risk. Now the only information they're likely to have to hand is the clinical history of their patient, in this case the parent. So if we can use that information to identify offspring who are at greatest risk, I think that's valuable in its own right. It might not tell us all that much about mechanisms, but it's important from a practical perspective. And the things that All of these factors predicted strongly psychopathology in young people. The presence of a severe episode in the parent, but also further recurrence across the study period. We looked at individual symptoms, and we didn't expect this at all, but we found that appetite and weight loss in the parents was the most predictive symptom of depression in young people. And then beyond depression, really important, is other co-occurring parental psychopathology. So typically, when we think about young people's disorders, we're immediately aware of the likelihood of comorbidity, of co-occurrence of different types of problems. In adults, perhaps less so. And actually, many of the parents in this sample experienced a whole range of problems. So these are the clinical features in terms of parents. Around 28% reported a very severe past episode of depression, which might involve being hospitalized or having attempted suicide, that kind of thing. Two-thirds experienced a further recurrence of a depressive episode since wave one of the study. The average age of onset was around in their mid-20s, and almost half, or close to half the sample, it wasn't just mum or dad who was depressed. There were multiple relatives, first and second degree relatives, who had experienced depression. So you can't see there, you probably can't see the writing on here, but this is what this shows are the rate, the percentage of young people who experienced a DSM-IV disorder by second follow-up. So this study was published halfway through our study. And according to whether mum's depression was severe and according to whether mum experienced a recurrence of depression since wave one, so between wave one and wave two. And that's important because if we think about depression, we know it runs in families, we know there's a genetic propensity. So the question of whether there are proximal risk effects over and above the severity of illness is really important. And what this shows is, yes, severity is important, but over and above, when we take account of severity, proximal recurrence in the past year and a half adds further risk. And so we can see that the rates vary, range from about 15% up to close to 40%, according to whether parents had one or both of those risk factors. This is some longitudinal analyses that Becky Mars, who is a PhD student of mine, Anita's, ran on the three-wave data now, looking at a similar question. And the question, not looking at disorder now, but on this side here, you can see symptom trajectories in the parent. And these are DSM depression symptoms assessed at each of the three waves. And using a trajectory class model, she divided the sample into those who are completely asymptomatic across the period of the study. So that's the 12% at the bottom there. Then you've got a subgroup, around a fifth of the, sorry, these are parents rather than mothers, parents who experience chronic high symptoms. So this is six. And if we think about diagnoses of the DSM depression, there's nine symptoms in total. So if you have six symptoms, that's very high. And there was around a fifth of the sample who experienced chronic high symptoms of depression. The majority were somewhere in the middle. They experienced one or two symptoms, but persistently across the course of the study. And if we looked at the outcomes for children in those three groups, that the children of the asymptomatic group were doing remarkably well. So only 5-6% reported any disorder at any of the three waves. But they're the exception. And then not unexpectedly, the chronic high group, the outcomes were particularly bad for that subgroup. But what's striking is this middle group, the children of the parents with mild symptoms, with 40% having experienced a psychiatric disorder by wave three, and one in six, a new onset depressive disorder. Now, this is really important because in the literature around parental depression and risk for children, Myrna Weissman and other studies and have the STAR-D trial have argued that if we successfully treat parents' depression, it improves outcomes for children. So one important intervention for this group might be not working with the children themselves, but just working on the parents, treating their depression, removing, reducing risk, and will improve outcomes. What this set of findings suggests is not sufficient to treat parents to the point where they don't meet criteria for depressive disorder. What you need to do is you need to treat parents to the point where they're asymptomatic. So one or two symptoms doesn't fulfill criteria for a depressive episode. So if they went to the doctor might say, you're well, you're no longer depressed, even if they're still reporting the old symptom. So I think that's important, has important clinical implications. Okay, so these are, I think these are kind of just, I'm less sure about these findings. It's even though it's one of the largest studies of its kind in the world, it's a relatively small study, and this is not at all what we expected to find. We thought we should look at what aspects of depression in parents predicts risk in children. We expected things like loss of enjoyment, negative cognition, suicidality. We could all imagine how those types of symptoms would psychosocially impact on young people. I can't see any reason, really, why weight loss, appetite loss in a parent would impact on children's well-being in of itself. But when we looked at the different symptoms, it was the one symptom that strongly predicted depression in the children prospectively. Didn't predict other types of outcomes, it was specific to depression. And then actually, when we looked further, it was appetite loss, weight loss rather than appetite change. This holds when you account for all the other remaining symptoms, and the other remaining symptoms don't add to the prediction over and above appetite and weight loss. So this clearly needs to be replicated, but there might be something in there that tells us something about the etiology and mechanisms of risk, but I don't know. And then I mentioned that many of the parents had other kinds of problems. We assessed anxiety, antisocial behaviour, and problem drinking using symptom screens, and we found, and what you can see here, is the prediction of new onset offspring psychopathology following baseline according to presence of co-occurring problems in mothers at baseline. And what you can see is that the risks are increased from around 15% for those who only had depressive disorder to around 35% for those who had multiple other types of problems. And that is controlling for measures of severity. All those other measures of parental depression severity I talked about, that's taken that into account. So these other forms of psychopathology, which are common in parents with depression.
What sort of problem?
So this is high anxiety scores,
right. According
to the HADS. It's antisocial behaviour, so it's being one standard deviation above the mean on the adult self-report, which is a measure of antisocial behaviour, hostility and so forth, and harmful drinking assessed using the audit. Okay. Right, so I realise I'm probably going to run out of time, so I'm going to speed through quite quickly some of these factors, but I just wanted to say we're interested in processes, what are the risk mechanisms, and I think this is quite an interesting series of analyses which is illustrative of the kinds of things ways we've been thinking about the data and exploring the data. And this is run by another PhD student of ours, Ruth Sellers, who's now a postdoc in Sussex. And we started with a well-known series of associations. We know that parental depression, she focused her analyses just on the mothers in the sample, so maternal depression, we know is associated with expressions of hostility or perception of hostile parenting by children. And we know that hostility impact is associated with psychopathology in children. So this is a sort of a model which mirrors what the kind of impressions in the literature, the theoretical impressions in the literature are. So maternal depression at baseline does indeed predict hostility at wave two, which impacts on depression symptoms at wave three. But we know, I've just told you, that a lot of the parents in this sample, a lot of the mothers in this sample, reported co-occurring problems. And one of those types of problems was antisocial behaviour. Well, actually, when we add that to the model, you've got the correlation, the association between maternal depression and antisocial behaviour at baseline. And when you take account of that, it's the antisocial behaviour that's driving the association with hostility. Depression, by in of itself, is not predicting hostile parenting. And the association with child depression is running via that route.
Can you just very briefly describe what you mean by antisocial behaviour, maternal antisocial behaviour?
In the parents?
Yeah.
And you put it. This is the adult self-report. It's a measure of traits, behaviours. It's not a criminality measurement. It's a measure of everyday behaviours.
Aggression,
but probably more verbal
violence?
Aggression. Not violence. No, it's relatively everyday types of behaviours. So irritability, outbursts, verbal aggression, things like that.
Towards the child or generally?
Generally. So this is a general measure, and the maternal hostility is expressions of hostility towards the child.
But the hostility is in a sense a sub of the maternal.
Yeah, they're different measures. So one is based on is meant to be a measure of the parent's own individual traits and behaviours. And one is the perception of those behaviours by the child of how that parent is acting towards them. And this is a similar model for child behaviour problems as the outcome, and you can see that we're finding that she found exactly the same patterns of results there. And I think that's important because I think often people are quick to I think that we have to be very careful when we present these findings, when we talk about these findings, that people don't think that we're blaming parents, and most of us are, we're mothers, that we're not blaming mothers or depressed mothers for the risk that is apparent in their children. And I think we need to be very careful where we ascribe that blame, whether we ascribe it to depression per se. And also, as that become clear when I talk about resilience, that we're not saying that things are inevitable. Okay, I'll very quickly talk about cognition, and I think it's a very different take on the whole question. And very quickly, this is a task that Fran Rice uses to assess risk-taking behaviour, reward-seeking behaviour. And children very simply have an option to, they have to decide whether they think this yellow marker will appear under a red block or a blue block. And if there's 8 red blocks and 2 blue blocks, the chances are it's going to appear under a red block rather than a blue block, just because it's random where it appears. The second decision they have to make is they have to decide how many of their points they're going to bet on that particular trial. Now, if there's 8 red blocks and 2 blue blocks, you're going to be pretty sure that it's going to appear under red block, whereas if it's, say, 6 red blocks and 4 blue blocks, you might not want to bet so much. So it's basic common sense, really. It might be as a basic IQ test.
That's why I've lost so much money on courses.
And as you'd expect, at the 6-4 ratios, people bet less than at the 9-1 ratios. But what we found is that, what she found, is that there's variation in that pattern according to whether you're depressed, whether you have no disorder, whether you have an externalizing disorder, or whether you have an anxiety disorder. The blue line is those children with no disorder, wave 2, and the red line here are those with depression. And this task, so the title of this paper was called The Risks of Playing It Safe. So it's a sort of an over-cautious, or it's either an aversion to risk, or it's almost like an anhedonia, that basically not being motivated to seek reward that this might be indexing. And importantly, it's not just a correlate of depression. It predicts new onset depression, this task. So this task, when I first heard her talk about it, I said, this is ridiculous, you know. it has no face validity, no meaning in real life. But it does predict new onset depression. So In children who are depression-free at baseline.
In what direction? I mean,
So
if at time one or two you're playing it safe, you're more likely to develop depression?
Yes. Yeah.
How do you explain the increase in the anxiety group between 9.1 and 8.2?
I'm not sure. I don't know. I doubt that that increase would be significant, actually. So I wouldn't read too much into it.
It's a statistical article.
Probably, yeah. Now she's interested in other cognitive factors. One factor that I think in the literature has become quite strongly associated with depression as a correlate is autobiographical memory. And you ask people to say to describe it, you know, tell me about one time when you were happy. And the idea is that people can vary in how specific they are in how they relate those memories. So they might go, when I go to the seaside, I'm happy. Or they might say, yeah, last holiday we went to the seaside and we were staying there and we did this and it was a bright sunny day and it was just this amazing thing happened. And that's a much more specific memory. And I think it's the literature suggests that it's been well established actually, that over general autobiographic memories are associated, are correlated with depression. And so she included a measure of this in the study as well. And it, first of all, and I think this is a bit more novel, is that this association is specific to depression, but also that it predicts depression. And this is a really interesting group of, one of the problems when you look at cognitive features, cognitive correlates of depression, is you never know whether they are symptoms of the disorder or even when the disorder is remitted, we're not sure really whether they're symptoms of an illness which is episodic. And I think looking in adolescents, in young people who we know are at high risk, but who haven't yet developed depression, is quite a strong design to argue that these are at least prognostic, perhaps. Yes?
So the two autobiographical memories and risk-taking are two predictors?
Yes. And then finally, there are a whole load of other cognitive factors, but I think this one is really interesting as well, and it's looking at cognitive ability. So these are basic IQ scores, and there's another set of findings using executive functioning measures of verbal fluency, response inhibition, as a separate measure rather than cognitive ability, but the pattern remains the same. So I'll talk you through this pattern. There's two studies here. There's a our study here, EPAD, on the right, and then a community study on the left that Fran set up in London. And the y-axis on each is on the left is depressive symptoms assessed using a symptom screen. Here it's depressive symptoms using the psychiatric interview. And the last column are the probability of a major depressive disorder. And then that's according to whether children have a low number of stressful life events or a high number of stressful life events, if you can see that there. And as you'd expect, children who've experienced more stressful life events have a higher rate of depressive symptoms, a higher risk of depressive episodes, and that's not novel. What we also find is, on the whole, depression is more, the children of low cognitive ability are more likely to develop depression. And that, again, is not that novel. But what we're finding is an interaction across all of these, both these measures and both studies, between cognitive ability and the exposure to stressful life events, suggesting that children who have higher IQ are more able, more resilient, more robust in the face of stress.
Were you also saying that it relates to the capacity to articulate and talk?
Yes, potentially. So one thing that we tried to do in this study is to try and understand what explains this interaction, what are the mechanisms by which, why is cognitive ability linked to this resilience, if you like, in the face of stress. And that we didn't get clear findings out of that. It might be that children who are brighter are more able to reinterpret stressors in a way that's adaptive, more able to plan and think of ways of coping with it. All of these are possibilities, but they didn't come out as significant mediators of this interaction in our model. The other possibility is that it's just linked to cognitive reserve. So when there's more stress going on, you have more cognitive, basic cognitive reserve to process all this at once without getting overwhelmed. Mm-hmm. And that might be the sort of default. But we don't know.
Am I misreading? Is it, are the boys different from the girls?
The boys are different from girls in this. Yes. So I did. So this set of findings seems specific to girls. Now, to me, and I'm a co-author on this paper, and that's what we said in the paper. To me, actually, the pattern doesn't look different enough to argue strongly that there really is a definite difference between girls and boys. It happened to be significant for girls, not for boys. But that's as far as I would go, and I think it needs further replication to
be. Am I right in thinking there are previous research studies suggesting that girls are more resilient than boys? And that's what I've always thought. Yeah. Yeah.
Girls can be more resilient. I think they're more sensitive to the environment. So that's so when there's girls, in many studies, are more sensitive to environmental influences, whether that be good or bad, in relation to depression, at least as an outcome.
And I've got no evidence for it, but I find that girls respond more with language, mm-hmm. use language more. If that's one of your characteristics, that's resilience.
Yes, I think that's a really good point. Now, I mean, in a different set of studies, we're looking at pragmatic language and social communication. What is clear to us is that where you've got especially stressful social circumstances, so difficult peer relationships, bullying, things like that, it seems to be girls who are more sensitive to that in terms of predicting depression. But it might, we don't know whether they're just more sensitive to negative events, negative influences, or they're just more sensitive to the environment, good or bad.
Have you got enough resources to do the continued prospective studies? It's such a rich pile of material, more likely to feel you're going to continue.
We've put in a grant proposal to track this sample now, so it's under review at the moment, and one of the aims will, we want to do the whole breadth of cognitive, clinical, social, psychosocial, but actually one of the you have to have one message in a grant proposal. So what we said we'd do is get these people, young people, into the lab and put them in a scanner and try and find out what's happening in their brains, as well as seeing whether we can, you know, so to try and give a bit more validity to some of the cognitive features of depression.
Yes, but prospective outcome studies are so rare on the ground, and you've got so much groundbreaking material here. One question for I, just to take one of many, is that actually diagnosing bipolar disorder during adolescence is an extremely dicey process, so saying we've eliminated is probably overconfident. And looking at that over 5 to 10 years would be very, very, very valuable. Absolutely, any resource, any which allows you to look at continuities and discontinuities over, say, 5 to 10 years.
Yeah.
And also, I would be very interested to know about access to services. Your GPs would be a very rich source of information on the difficulties of accessing psychiatric services when they would choose to, if they are wanting to, particularly with CAMs, which are so thinly serviced. What do they do about that?
I think it's a really good point, and I think there's two strategies in terms of follow-up and of this sample. One is to keep this sample and keep going with the detailed assessments, face-to-face assessments, lab-based assessments. The other is, in Wales, we have the opportunity to link to SAIL, which is a database, registered database, and so where you can link health records to individual information. And so for all of our studies in our department, what we're planning to do now is to ask for consent for record linkage with SAIL. Now, that would allow us, that part of it, would allow us to track indefinitely without having to go back and re-recruit the sample, to track service use, to track bipolar, which typically will appear on records.
And in a long-term study, the possibility of knowing whether these parents have children who also carry
a third generation. Yes.
And you could also look at DSM-5, using the American classification, DSM-5 and ICD-11.
Yeah.
The difference in identification of illness. So you've got huge potential for further research.
Definitely. I think it's the hardest thing with this study, when we're trying to write grant applications around to justify the follow-up, is picking which question we're trying to solve, because I think we have to try and narrow it down. Okay, I don't want to talk for too much longer, so I'll briefly show you I said children also influence parents, and I think this is a set of cross-like models, and it's showing that behaviour symptoms at time one is associated with hostile parenting. That's not surprising. Hostile parenting predicts change in behaviour symptoms over time. But we're also seeing the converse, that behaviour symptoms in children is predicting an increase in parental hostility. So that's well established actually in the literature. What was more interesting to us is to see whether children, the emergence of psychopathology, which often happens in adolescence, whether that changes parents' illness course. These are parents with a long-standing history of depressive disorder. So what's happening to them? Are they more likely to experience recurrence of depression when their children develop a disorder? You know, are symptoms in the children, are they changing, driving change in symptoms in parents? And each additional symptom, child depression symptom, at baseline, added 9% increase to the risk of a recurrence in parents by follow-up. And as you can see here from the cross-lab model, if we're just focusing on symptoms, child symptoms, or girl symptoms in particular, is driving change in maternal symptoms, and actually not vice versa when we take account of those bidirectional associations. Perhaps we can come back to those points in the discussion, because I did want to say something about resilience. And I'll try and keep it short. I think resilience, what do we mean by resilience? When I talk about resilience anywhere, people immediately jump to the kind of definitional issues and the concept, you know. Some people really like the idea of resilience, most people seem to really hate the idea of the concept of resilience. Very crudely, what I mean is that it relates to variation in outcomes within a high-risk group. So many studies compare high risk with low risk and say this group is at risk of this. Actually, within this high risk group, you've got a whole myriad of outcomes, some better, some worse. And I think it's trying to understand that variation in risk within high risk groups. And in particular, I think resilience refers to better than expected adaptation given the severity of risk to which you've been exposed. And that can be assessed in two ways, using a person-based approach. Within this sample, is there a subgroup who don't develop mental health problems? Not at wave one, not at wave two, not at wave three, not according to parents, not according to child. They're mentally healthy. To me, that, I think, self-evidently is resilience. But as important, we can also predict symptom scores at follow-up, depression symptom scores, behavior symptom scores, using all of the different measures of parental severity that I talked about. And then we can actually look at children's symptom scores. And are they worse than we predicted or better than we predicted? So these are residual scores in a regression model. And that's another sort of more variable-based definition of resilience, if you like. And why is it important? Well, actually, ideally, we want to remove risk. We'd want to reduce risk, but it's not always possible. So many parents with depression don't seek treatment. Some parents, or many parents who seek treatment, don't get better. They have treatment-resistant depression, if you like. So it's not always possible to eliminate risk or reduce risk. So identifying risk buffers is just as important, I think, for prevention and intervention. And Anne Maston wrote a very lovely paper, I think, a few years ago now, which had the words ordinary magic in the title. And what she was getting at is that many of the factors that promote resilience, the protective factors, are not really hard to attain, difficult things. They're actually potentially quite ordinary things. Having someone to talk to, having a good friend, changes in how you see yourself, maybe in relation to depression, she doesn't mention this, maybe just going out and exercising more, sleeping better, things like that. Things which are within reach, so ordinary magic. And I think there's some, though there has been a bit of research around the resilience in offspring of depressed parents. What we don't know is whether adaptive functioning, where it's been looked at, is evident across multiple domains of mental health, not just depression, whether it's sustained across time. Crucially, whether apparent resilience simply reflects variation in risk exposure. So I've already shown you that this group, all of them have recurrent depression, but there's a wide variation in the severity of that depression. Are there cumulative effects across different predictive domains? So this is how we defined our good mental health subgroup. They're children with no DSM-IV disorder at any wave, children with less than 3 symptoms of depression, less than 3 symptoms of behaviour disorders at every wave, and no suicidality or self-harm at any wave. And that picked up a fifth of our sample who had sustained good mental health. And we also compared that group to general population norms using the strength and difficulties questionnaire. And what we found from that is that they had better mental health than the average child in the average school. So they're doing okay. And then when we looked at predictors of what distinguished this subgroup from the rest of the sample, what we found is that there are a number of different factors which are important, and across these different domains, so the family domain, the social domain, and the child domain. And you can see the odds ratios for yourself on here. All of those are significant predictors of resilience, if you like. But importantly, they're additive effects across these different factors. And I think if we think about intervention at the moment, many interventions for depression are focused on one of these domains, cognitive behavioural therapy, family therapy, if you like. And what this is suggesting, if we look at these two bars here, very few of the children were resilient, even when they had 2 or 3 of those protective factors in their favour. And just to remind ourselves what they were, because positive parenting, co-parents' emotional support, good peer relationships, self-efficacy, and exercising. So even when you had 3 of those things going in your favour, rates of resilience were low. Really, you need to have lots of things across multiple domains which are going well for you. So this is the analysis of the continuous outcome scores, these residual scores, where a negative residual score is good. You've got lower symptoms than we predicted, given how depressed your parent was. And the findings are pretty consistent, perhaps with one major exception, that you've got 2 specific effects. The index parent's positive parenting was only related to conduct symptoms, and physical exercise was only protective for depression and not for behaviour, which is what you'd expect. I think maybe children who are going around stealing and fighting, you don't want them to exercise more, maybe sit down and take a rest. There's an important point here, is that when we talk about mental health resilience, we have to bear in mind that the processes, the risk processes, but also the resilience mechanism might vary according to the outcome of interest.
And self-efficacy, what's that?
Self-efficacy is a measure of how well you think you can cope with difficulties that come your way, to put in a nutshell. Okay.
Coming from another theoretical perspective, you might call that secure attention.
Possibly. For which one?
The characteristics of self-efficacy and warm relationships, that's it.
Yes.
Yeah.
I think it's I think the attachment is important, but we've looked in another study, which is the offspring study, and I'm not going to present the results today, just an interesting time. And we looked at very early measures of parenting and parent-child relationships, and they predict forward 10, 12 years to mental health resilience, if you like, in those where parents are depressed. So I think that fits with the idea that I think maybe an intellectual perspective is informative. Okay, I'm just going to wrap up now, and I wanted to leave time, obviously, for discussion. And just to say, I think the sort of headline messages from this body of work is that parental recurrent depression is associated with substantial problems in children, mental health problems. They're a very high risk group, and not just depression. So I think often people are focused just on homotopic continuities, homotopic patterns of association, even intergenerationally. The majority of the disorders we picked up in this sample were not actually depression of young people. So anxiety disorders was the most common, followed by behavior disorders, then equally prevalent, ADHD and depression. So it started off as a study that aimed to predict depression, but actually it's a study that found that we need to focus much more generally on mental health outcomes in this group. We can prospectively identify, even just using the measures of parents' clinical history, quite well those who are at ultra high risk, if you like, if we were thinking about wanting to intervene preventively in some of these families. I think that, and I didn't mention this too much, but I think we need to bear in mind that there's a debate in the literature around whether all of this is just genetic association. We know mental health problems, depression runs in families. Are all of these features of the study, are they just reflections of genetic liability? Now, it's not a genetically sensitive design, but what I would say is there is other literature from adoption studies which suggests that even in genetically unrelated mother-child pairs, there's strong evidence for associations between maternal parental depression and child negative outcomes. And in our study, proximal exposure to depression in parents over the past year strongly added to risk indexed by past severity and family history and so forth.
So what you're saying is that genetics is a partial, but only a partial explanation
yes,
for depression.
Absolutely.
Can you go further than that and say what proportion of depression is more or less is likely to be explained by?
Not from this design. I think what we will be
able.
You have twin studies and so forth which partition liability into genetic and shared environment, non-shared environment. I think I'm becoming a little bit more sceptical about that approach because actually genetic risk effects are mediated by environmental mechanisms.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And environmental risk effects are moderated by genetic.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
So I think that we need to see those as working together. There's a different study altogether. It's an adoption study which Gordon Harold, who's a collaborator on this, has talked about to me before, and he said, if you measure risk in the biological parent, you can show a strong effect on child outcomes, their biological child's outcomes, who are now in an adoptive family, but it's mediated via the adoptive parent's parenting. Which is suggesting, actually, and if you look further then, and that effect is mediated via child temperament. So you've got a genetic mediation which is mediated through evocative child effects on parents and then parent effects on children. So I think we need to think much more beyond this dichotomy of genes versus environment, but we certainly shouldn't ignore that genetics plays an important role.
And there's also evidence that if you work with the parents of children who are genetically high risk, you can actually reduce
yes,
the outcomes for children. So in terms of intervention, working with parents of high risk, of genetically high risk children, is actually beneficial.
Including in adoption designs, do you mean, or just those where the parents and the children are genetic high risk?
Probably both, but mainly in birth
yes,
children.
This is clearly, whenever I give this talk in the department, because I'm Centre for Neuropsychiatric Genetics and Genomics, and they all want to know what I'm doing to advance the course of psychiatric genetics, I say this is a sample at familial risk. You know, so they are clearly at familial, at high genetic risk. We have got measures of that, and we will move on to looking at those using, for example, polygenic residuals. We haven't.
Have you found that the study had interested your adult mental health clinical colleagues?
Absolutely.
Because in terms of policy development, when I was at the Department of Health, trying to get adult mental health policy to take any interest, really, in the impact of adult disorders on children was pretty well near impossible.
No, I think that, I mean, that's something that I would say is quite strongly apparent, and one of the reasons why I like working with our work is that there's a strong integration of, you know, we see childhood, neurodevelopmental, childhood onset, adolescent onset disorders as lifelong disorders. The manifestation might change when you get into adulthood, but likewise, actually, schizophrenia, adult onset disorder, schizophrenia, psychosis, they're neurodevelopmental disorders. Mm-hmm. With you know, to understand them, you need to understand development from conception onwards, really. So,
just picking up on what Bob's just said, I mean, I'm coming from a social policy perspective, I'm quite interested in some of the countries that are moving away from GDP growth as a measure of progress, and using alternatives such as improvements in happiness indexes or well-being. And some of those countries are even experimenting with things like mental health impact statements, so that when they introduce new social and economic policies, they look at the potential impact in terms of their well-being or happiness index. And I wonder if you'd ever sort of thought about the work you're doing in that context.
Not so much this study, perhaps, but one of my other interests is in population trends in mental health. So I've published quite a lot on looking at whether symptoms of mental health problems, child psychiatric disorders, have become more prevalent over time. And so I think that is directly relevant. And I think one of the things that, just to pick up on that point about well-being and mental health, I would say they're different things. So if we look at trends in adolescent depression, if we look at trends in youth suicide, for example, they often run in very different ways from trends in life satisfaction and happiness. So you get many more people, I think, saying that they're happy, but you also get more young people saying that they feel stressed, anxious and depressed at the same time. So I think we need to not see them as really proxies for one another.
There's a difference between the aggregate and the individual level, of course, in that respect. So I imagine that at the individual level, those who are reporting that they're depressed are probably not very happy.
Yeah. Yes.
But at the aggregate level, I can see how that would work. Yes.
Some years ago, did you account for causal factors at all? Because I have a vague memory of a Reef lecture many years ago, either by the Professor of Peace Studies or the Professor of War Studies at Bradford University, I can't remember which, basically saying that there had been an economic audit of two world wars, there had been a historic audit, there had been all sorts of audits, but there had never been a mental health audit.
Yeah.
And what he was talking about was the effect of the effect on parenting of two successive world wars on successive generations. And I just wondered whether, to what extent post-traumatic stress disorder as a historical factor was something that he'd ever looked at?
I don't know. I think I don't know if you've read Steven Pinker's book, and, you know, I can't remember what it's called, Better Angels About Nature, but I think that suggests that actually society as a whole, despite the two world wars, has become a lot less violent over the last century and the last few centuries. So I think in terms of the impacts of things like world wars, I mean, I'm not sure how it would play out in this sample, for example. But yeah, I think one of the opportunities we have in the UK is we have got successive cohorts. We've got the 58 birth cohort, we've got the 1970 birth cohort, the ALSPAC study, the Millennium Cohort study, you know, the various ONS surveys, and many of those capture elements of parental well-being, most, you know, they're intergenerational studies, if you like. So we can explore those historical trends in influences on parental well-being and also how that relates to childhood.
There's also an international society with the study of traumatic stress, which is looking, to a conference, look at everything from the effects of families owning guns in America to third and fourth generation Holocaust survivors. There's a wide range of knowledge much of which, mercifully within this country, yes. is comparatively limited, mm. but you get very different studies in Uganda or Congo
yeah.
or
yes.
In American central cities.
Yeah. I mean, I think, so just to pick up on the idea of sort of post-traumatic stress and chronic stress and adversity, and I think the one study that I'm aware of that I think is very interesting was done after 9/11, and it was looking at children's proximity to that, whether they'd been, say, in the building, had lost someone who'd been in the building, whether they'd seen it, whether they'd been in the city, or whether they were outside the city, mm-hmm. And then looking at how that related to mental health symptoms. And it related, but it related not nearly as strongly as measures of chronic adversity, yeah. local neighbourhood poverty,
yeah.
exposure to bullying and things like that. So I think it's important to think, I think, I'm not an expert, but I imagine that chronic stress is just at least just as important mm. as...
When you were looking at the children and you look at the cognitive ability, were they also tested for other comorbid, as it were, difficulties, learning difficulties?
So there's an exclusion in the study that we excluded those with very profound learning disabilities. Mm-hmm. So it was IQs less than 50 we excluded. We didn't, it's a continuous score. Most of the children, I don't think, had learning disabilities, but we didn't control for that. I'm not sure whether you'd want to when cognitive, so you've got a categorical, you're splitting your IQ into two categories, so why would you need to, I guess you would want to see whether the findings hold when you just look at those who haven't got learning.
I was thinking more of something like Asperger's syndrome, where there is allegedly a sort of more predictable track of becoming depressed as an adolescent.
Yeah.
And a much higher level of undiagnosed autistic spectrum disorder or Asperger's in the female population than the male population.
I agree, I think it's important. I think that, so ADHD as well, there's, childhood ADHD links strongly to hence for becoming depressed. I think what was interesting about those findings is that, this is the low cognitive ability group here, and what it's suggesting is that the this is the low cognitive ability here, and it's suggesting that the reason for the association with depression is a greater susceptibility to environmental stressful life events, rather than, I can see both points of this argument, but one argument might be that if you have a neurocognitive disability, that's an underlying dispositional trait and risk that you carry for depression with you. But what this is arguing is that risk associated with low cognitive ability is much more situationally dependent on recent stressful life events.
What you've been talking about has enormous implications for people who are working in the adoption offspring. And I thought I might perhaps just finish with an anecdote where an exceedingly difficult 10-year-old boy was placed in a family with two teenage girls. They were assessed as very well functioning, very resilient, no previous problems. The father, the adoptive father, could not cope with this boy's terrible behaviour and went into a very severe depression, left the family. Mother then did terribly well with both the teenage girls and the boy, and he has turned out smashingly, but we're left with a marriage broken up and a father still, I think, chronically depressed.
I think that captures pretty much everything.
What about the children when they were younger? I mean, you pick them up at quite an older age. I mean, the group of children who come into care because of severe mental illness of a parent, and when people have worked with them in various clinical ways and life story work, one of the things is that your very young children can't understand mother's behaviour when mothers suffer from depression because it blows hot and cold. And it's very difficult for a 3 or 4 year old. Mm-hmm. Cope with that. that must cause some damage early on.
Well, we don't know from this. I mean, I think the other point you're sort of hinting at is children's own perception and understanding
which goes back
of
to
their
parents. It's interesting, in therapeutic communities where you have children who suddenly change mood, they have to explain to other children why this is happening. And okay. You can't say it's because he's got Asperger's syndrome. You say, in a mood. That's how they do it. They say, Joyce is in a mood, which means she's on the roof throwing tiles. And it's quite an interesting way of explaining something to children that they can perhaps comprehend. People have moods, you know, and sometimes it's good and sometimes it's bad. Very simple. But I think the early experiences of children with depressive illness, their parents, must cause some damage, mustn't it? That you're picking up when they're 9 or 10.
Yeah. I mean, one thing that we wanted to, but couldn't for ethical reasons do, is ask the young people whether they knew that their parent was depressed. Mm-hmm. So, and Mark Rutter, when we talked about the study to him a few years ago, he said, one of the characteristics of depression is that it feels like hostility and unreasonableness to those around you without being necessarily knowing that this is a disorder.
Yeah.
Whereas, and his hypothesis might be that actually if you looked at children or parents with much worse mental health problems in some ways, like schizophrenia, the outcomes in some ways might be better. Because the children know this is this disorder, and this is the explanation for why this person is behaving like that.
Yeah. Now, the whole study seems to be, have this challenge of dealing with the generalized semantic term depression and the clinical sub-definitions, which are known to specialists but are not known to the general public, who still think of depression either in terms of blame or in terms of extremely general terms. Mm. So if you ask most people in the population, for example, well, you know, what is depression? Mm. I wonder how many of them would include attention deficit disorder, anxiety states, and the other things that you clinically listed.
Mm-hmm.
And that, and therefore, going back to right at the beginning of the study, when people go to the doctor, if they go to the doctor, if they register, which is another big issue, I mean, they may say, I'm just feeling under the weather.
Yeah.
Or I've been feeling under the weather for a long time, or they may say, my husband's been beating me up.
Yeah. Yeah.
But well, it's from that backache. Someone presents with backache, there's a high probability of it's depression on the line of depression. Is that right?
Well, it's one, yes.
I don't
Can I just follow Aaron's question, though? Because I didn't understand you to say that depression includes ADHD and includes it. I thought you were talking about associations.
Yeah, it doesn't.
And comorbidities.
Yes.
I think it actually included. I think the weight loss and loss of appetite, which I think you're saying are cardinal features of people in the populace may not associate with depression. But I didn't think that you were saying that things like ADHD were a feature of,
they're disorders which are associated with. So I think what I was saying earlier is that if we, in another big sample that we have in one of our main samples in our group in Cardiff, is a study of ADHD. And we're quite interested to see what will happen to them as they grow up. And in childhood, many of those children also have co-occurring autism spectrum disorders, co-occurring conduct disorders, but they're in some sense separate diagnostic entities, and we expect that as they become teenagers, they will develop other disorders, including depression and substance use disorders. So, you know, just to finish that point, there is actually now also a big move in the community, I think perhaps also clinically, but certainly in the research community, is to step away from those diagnostic labels a little bit. And recognise that actually, really, we need to be understanding reward processing, or anhedonia, or inattention, rather than ADHD or social communication. And I think so. I think it's a different debate. But I think
Can we just unpack this weight loss, appetite loss thing a bit? Because one of the symptoms of anxiety is likely to be appetite loss. you have high level anxiety, you don't eat.
Yep.
And I'm just wondering, there's also quite a strong overlap between anxiety and aggression. So I'm wondering to what extent, you know, your predictor is actually a symptom, and what you need to do is unpack that symptom in order to arrive at a different set of predictors.
Okay, so in that instance, we were interested to see which of the core cardinal symptoms of depression in parents most strongly predicted the emergence of depression in children. So there's some evidence, there's some interest that you get that we can subtype depression, for example. But we were also interested, so that might be one explanation, that you've got different subtypes of depression. The other explanation might be we expected that there would be certain features in the way that depression is manifest, that those behaviours, those manifestations will impact on children. And I think what that finding suggests is that it's indexing a type of depressive liability that is shared with children, because I can see no reason why losing weight or losing appetite in of itself would be depressogenic.
Well, that goes back to my days as a medical student.
Family life, isn't it? I mean, that's
yes, it will impact on family meal times and so forth. So yes, we should check that. Yes, you're right.
If I go back to learning about depression as a medical student, I mean, you know, there was a sort of core category of biological depression. One of the major features was appetite and weight loss.
Yes.
As a core symptom of a type of depression. Yes. So you're saying that in a sense probably still has some validity.
Possibly. I think this is the most tentative finding out of all of them, I think.
That's an interesting one. Though.
Because it's certainly one that we didn't hypothesise.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
But I'm just worried that this is tautological.
In what sense?
Well, in the sense that you've ended up with a predictor, which is a symptom of the thing you're actually predicting.
But it's a symptom of the parents, and we're predicting the child's... So we're using parents' symptoms to predict child new onset depressive disorder. So if we think about, suppose we were, all of these families were recruited via GPs. Suppose the GP suddenly put two and two together and realised, actually, all my patients have children, they might be at risk for depression. Which of those families, which of those children should I focus on most? Well, actually, we're saying, if the parent has lost a lot of weight, if they've had a recent recurrence, if they've got co-occurring problems, is that subgroup within our sample, within this doctor's patient group, they need to be most worried about the children?
I think what I'm saying is the fact that they're losing weight or not eating is because they're depressed. And therefore you're saying that parental depression predicts child depression.
It is because they're depressed, but there's other features of depression in the parents that... We looked at each of the different symptoms in the parents, and yes, they have concentration problems because they're depressed. They have mood problems, loss of enjoyment because they're depressed. But those symptoms are not predicting new onset depression in the children. It's a subgroup of depressed parents. All of them are depressed. It's a subgroup who've experienced weight, appetite, and weight loss.
And was sleep.
But maybe we can. I think I'm missing your point.
I think it's a really interesting thing. Uh-huh. It's the one that sticks out probably more than anything else. It's the biggest predictor, and therefore it needs unpacking somehow. For me, to make sense, it needs unpacking a bit more. But
you're completely right. We do need to unpack it. But I think what we need to believe it before we unpack it, I think.
Okay,
and I think we need to replicate it.
Yes,
and I think it's a relatively small subset of parents who experience this particular symptom.
What about sleep? Was that linked as well? And because it associated, you know, appetite, weight loss, early morning waking, and that sort of thing, that wasn't part of it.
No.
That's interesting.
Mm. Could I ask whether in your sample, is it an all-white sample, or are there any ethnic differences in the parents?
It's mostly all-white.
No findings that one could be.
No, we didn't look at, no, I can't remember what the mix is.
Can I ask you a question about, in a sense, related to... possibly social policy. As you know, there's this army of wonderful people being trained under CY J, children, young people higher, as we speak, on counselling for depression and behaviour changes in depression and so on. And you know, this is a big industry with big money, government run. Looking back at your slide about the cumulative efficacy, if it's if a lot of money is being focused and resources being focused on dealing with a small part for the young people in terms of depression, so it would be self-efficacy, and what was the other one? And the young people themselves, self-efficacy, and I forgot what the other one is, exercise.
Yes.
And that in itself isn't going to achieve a whole lot unless you attend to these other factors in the parent-child relationship and also in the parents, and peer relationship quality. Is what you're finding being listened to by the IAP people?
That's a very good point, yes.
I mean, I'm asking this because I'm going to meet him about tomorrow, so I'm very good for him.
Well, so we haven't, we haven't talked about that.
So then they need to know about this. Because, I mean, you know, if they're investing a whole lot in counselling in schools for young people with depression, but it's actually the cumulative factors which affect prognosis, then that's a social policy.
Yeah. I mean, we've worked, what we're trying to do is sort of get the word out to those who are developing and implementing interventions that, we should think about both parents being involved in the intervention. We should think about intervention more broadly. We've got someone who's working with us in the area of psychoeducation. Actually, one of the sort of questions I was going to raise, and this leads up to this point I was going to make, is that we need to ask, is it ethical to be screening and identifying risk in these young people if there are no interventions available to them in practice? And just to say, in terms of the services that they've received, and I didn't come onto that, the majority of the young people hadn't received any services. And a third of those who had a psychiatric disorder now and were suicidal or self-harming now had never seen any services.
But as you were saying, actually, some of them aren't, it's not about services, it's about some very simple things. So my question is, have the GPs picked up on these results? Because I could, my head, you've got a child who's at risk, and it might be that that GP says to grandma, who might look down the road, see Johnny a bit more, and actually, establishing those relationships which may help that child. It's not just about specialist services, is it, that increases the resilience?
I think in terms of a group-based prevention approach, we do need to think about fostering those factors together to promote resilience in those who are at high risk. I think when you've got a young person who's got a clear psychiatric disorder and who's suicidal, I think we can't expect that clinically we can turn them into someone who's resilient overnight by asking them to... So I think we need to...
There's
two different issues. So I think there's the services and there's the prevention.
Yeah. Online, have the GPs had these results, and are they?
We have newsletters which gets, we send out newsletters on the findings. We need to amalgamate a set of findings now. That a lot of these papers are from this year, but we need to repeat that set of dissemination. So they haven't had these set of resilience findings yet.
In terms of protective services, the provision of food and enjoyable experiences, which are core aspects of therapeutic communities, for example, would be relatively easy to set up, I would have thought.
So what would you have in mind?
I would have in mind being able to offer local facilities where children could come with no stigma. They might perhaps do cooking, but there would be plenty of good food, and there would be other enjoyable experiences associated with it.
You've done a study of 315 families in South Wales, parents in South Wales. What's the scale nationally of this problem?
I think it's very big. I think it's we repeated this set of analysis in the ALSBAP cohort, and we found that actually the largest attributable risk associated with parental depression was in that group of parents who had sub-threshold symptoms of depression, and that includes almost half the population of, you know.
And in the school population of 1,000 youngsters, adolescents?
Well, you know, yes, I mean, you can extrapolate. I mean, I think the prevalence of adult depression is around 20 to 30% during the parenting years. So, and clearly the worse that depression, the more pernicious and more recurrent that depression is, the worse the risk at the individual level. But at the school level, at the population level, you know, just because of the greater exposure, you know, the greater frequency of risk, the largest risk is probably carried by mild depression and mild persistent depression.
On the weight dimension, how, if at all, does the obesity problem fit into it?
Well, I'm not anticipating that it's going to make people happy.
No, I was thinking about depression being associated with obesity.
It is associated with obesity. I think we have done some analyses where, and I think it's quite interesting, those analyses are quite challenging when we've looked at obesity or BMI, is because you have a curvilinear relationship. Mm. It's underweight, it's just as strongly associated with depression as overweight, and probably more so. But it gets very hard to model when you've got this pattern where the two extremes are associated with risk, and they're quite rare within a relatively small sample.
So I was thinking rather simply that if people are severely obese and they lose weight, mm-hmm. Their depressive symptoms may actually be ameliorated.
I'm sure they would. Yeah. I think the critical thing is, why is there weight loss going on in that clinical picture? Whether if it's a core feature of depression, if it's happening because of depression, that might be indexing subgroup risk.
Can you just put the back on that previous slide again?
And there's also one which you had with which correlated with depression and conduct disorder differentially. We said self efficacy.
Do you want me to move down to that one?
Hang on.
Can you say something about, we're whispering about something called a place to be, for instance, as an example of intervention in schools, and I'm also talking about the IAP thing. Are these related to children at the high end of depressive symptoms, or does this go across the board for milder depression?
In terms of, sorry, the children's end?
Well, you see, if Bob was just saying that there have been good results with intervening with children alone in terms of depressive symptoms.
Well, not specifically depression, but children with presenting with problems. Yeah.
Problems. And I've always believed that you have to intervene across the board, and certainly with parents as well. And that's what this suggests. But does this relate only to children with really more severe depressive symptoms, or does this relate across the board in terms of severity?
Well, the analysis we ran for the resilience set of analyses were focused on it's actually the avoidance of a broad group of mental health, negative mental health outcomes, including disorder as well as sub-threshold symptomatology. I think most of the findings that we've run, most of the studies that we've run, we've been quite careful to try and replicate our findings using dimensional outcomes where we're looking at depressive symptoms across the board,
right.
Which are typically skewed, so you're comparing two symptoms versus one or one versus zero,
yeah.
But also looking at whether we can predict whether the same associations hold when we look at depressive disorder, and also when we look at new onset depression, so in those who weren't depressed, do they become depressed? And I think typically the findings have been quite consistent across that set of analyses, and I haven't done that for each of the findings I've done.
In terms of policy for intervention, this is hugely important.
It is really important. What we can't do, and I think the one thing that I would say is when we look at depressive disorder in adolescents, and it's not, I'm not a clinician, but I was a co-author on a review that we did in The Lancet a few years ago, and the clinical part was written by someone else, but from what I remember of it, the management of severe depressive disorder is very different from mild depressive disorder, which again, when I say mild, it still meets criteria for depression. It's not really mild, it's not sub-threshold, but it's the differentiation in the clinical severity of depression once it's diagnosed, and the management, I think, is quite different in terms of use of antidepressants or not, for example. So I think it's important not to confuse those issues. I think when we're, if we're thinking about intervention at the community level, when we're thinking about prevention, I think we want to not only prevent episodes, but we also want to reduce symptoms. Does that answer your question?
Yes, but are you saying to complete that sentence that the intervention is required both at the child level and at the parent-child level?
Absolutely, yes. Yeah. Right. I think they need to, it needs to include
multiple levels. Yeah. Whereas with severe, you may have to focus specifically on the young person in addition to the others, in terms of not giving the whole family antidepressants, but only to the child.
Yeah, well, I think the decision to prescribe antidepressants needs to be done on an individual basis, and I think shouldn't really be informed by necessarily this, but I think that,
Could you talk a bit about the complex interaction between human unhappiness and grief, which are part of being alive, and depression? This is one of the most difficult diagnostic issues, and I'm not sure that you can practice 10-minute sessions with people saying, by the way, doctor, is there need, or in a very... However intelligent and able they are, they're structurally in a very difficult position to do that.
Yeah.
How has that affected your study?
I'm sure it's affected our study to some degree, but I think it's important to remember that we have quite a high threshold for recruitment into the study from the parents, so it's recurrent depressive disorder.
Yeah.
We confirmed, we didn't just go by GP records, we reconfirmed that.
The parents will help you to think about this very complex spectrum.
I think they're different issues, and I think if we look in the, and I think there are cultural differences in how that plays out in research, actually. If we look at US studies, the prevalence of depression can be enormously high because there's very little attention to anything beyond the presence of symptoms, which might be reactions to grief, it might be reactions to recent stress. But I think that what we've tried to do in our research is look at the impact of symptoms on functioning. So I think mental illness is more than just a set of symptoms, it's how that set of symptoms impacts on your day-to-day life and your ability to carry on.
Yes, that's a very good point. You listen to the people who are presenting the symptoms rather than just the presenting agent. It's very good.
Another study which I've been involved with, which is colleagues at Oxford, looked at orphans through HIV AIDS in South Africa and mental health resilience in that group. And it's quite clear that there's a differentiation between reactions to grief associated with that, and actually the impact that that has in terms of trauma on mental health. And also that, like this study, you see that resilience is eminently possible for many, but it involves multiple facets of protective factors, and I think that's quite interesting that you're getting that convergence at that level across these two very different studies.
There are other traumas as well I've experienced in families that lead to what appears to be depression, like abuse or violence, or like issues related to it, which make it not just about treating depression.
Yes. I mean, I think you need to take a whole family perspective within this and take a broad look at what different factors are playing out. We didn't. One of our aims was to identify risk and protective, to try and understand proximal risk mechanisms, where we take risk factors like exposure to stressful life events and see how that then plays out, increasing risk for depression. Our other aim was to identify potentially modifiable protective factors that could be targeted in preventions. But I think I take your point that at the individual level and treatment and clinical perspective, you may find one family, and actually, this research perspective really doesn't tell you enough about what's happening with this family, this child, in the here and now. And I think clearly at that level you then need to use common sense and clinical good judgment to decide what the key is.
I mean, I was just wondering in the last few minutes whether you could say, you've touched on some of the studies you're going to be doing, but whether you could say, A, how you're taking these messages out, how you're going to be letting them be known, and what further research you're doing.
Okay, and further research, well, we're certainly going to aim to follow this sample up. As I mentioned, I think it's a hugely important sample, and I think it's important to track this sample into young adulthood, because they're not passed through that. I'd said the peak incidence for depression isn't early adulthood. We haven't got there yet. So in terms from a risk perspective, from a resilience perspective, maybe we're misclassifying children as being resilient when they're not really, they haven't yet developed depression. But also, it'll tell us so much as we've already discussed. I think we will take this forward into neuroscience by doing imaging at the, we've got a new imaging centre at Cardiff next to our building, which I think will be potentially very interesting. And also integrating genetics into this, you know, measured genetics and how that relates to environment. But we don't want to lose sight of the important phenotypic issues and the psychosocial issues within this sample. And I think, so that's one way we're going to plan to do that with this sample. Other research I'm interested is to take this forward at the population level and track the links between child vulnerabilities, child mental health problems, adolescent and then adult mental health problems, and take a whole life perspective, a life course perspective to looking at these issues.
And are you thinking about, we talk about how do, you know, the clinicians get hold of it, but the public policy issues that potentially are a bit.
I'd really like some advice on that, actually. It's not something that I have that much expertise in. I mean, clearly we're writing these up, we're giving lots of talks on these. We communicate a lot with our clinical colleagues, our colleagues in Welsh, you know, in Welsh Assembly Government, give talks to clinicians, to medical students. But really we need to be thinking, I think, a bit more strategically now that we've got to this point where most of the papers from this phase of swathe of studies have been published. How do we target strategically to get these messages out to the best effect? And so any advice on that from, you know, I think that's really something that I appreciate.
One of the things I would do straight away is I would perhaps set up a workshop which tested out the potential impact of your research and similar research in terms of the social policy to reduce tax credits.
Sorry, the
to reduce tax credits. The reduction in tax credits is going to impact on certain families quite profoundly, and that impact on those families is likely to lead in some of those families to members of those families experiencing depression, which in turn could affect the children.
Yeah.
So you could take a current social policy like that and see through a discussion with people who understand the policy of social tax credits, but also can know about the links between external factors that impinge upon the stress levels within families, and the links between that and depression within those families.
Do you know if the shift in tax credits, that's going to happen overnight? Yeah.
Wait till after the interim statement.
Yeah.
That's likely it's going to hit families. One day it'll happen, the next day they won't.
We need to wait until the autumn statement, which is 24th of November, I think it is. And he may roll back completely on it, but I doubt it. I still think there will be a proportion of families that will be very hard hit by the reduction in tax credits. It will probably be either less of a hit or fewer families, but there will still be a hit somewhere. And that could be a testing out of your. That could be a
mechanism. I think that's really, really important, and I think it's. Yeah.
But the people who were interviewed after the steel ships and Red Cross steel producers who closed down were talking about increased depression in
families. Yeah, for sure.
Do you know if the shift in tax credits, is that going to affect the whole of the UK? Was Wales sort of exempted itself?
No, Wales is not
exempted. No, it's a choose Wales.
I guess the other group that you ought to bear in mind, linking back to what we were talking about yesterday, is the Youth Offending Service. Mm-hmm. Because there must be implications for what you've been saying in relation
all throughout, to I was, you know, we worked with young offenders and mothers, and you feel a depressiveness in many of the families, you know, just that curtains or clothes and you know, that sort of atmosphere. But the times that mothers towards their adolescents are behaving badly, so he's driving me mad, he's really going to make me crack up, and you,
yeah.
And it actually is an association.
And there are elements within the Welsh Assembly that are looking at that. You make that connections with them already. And within the Welsh Assembly, sure, they're connected.
You might want to think about a possible workshop at the Association of Lawyers for Children conference next year. It sounds like a narrow audience. It isn't. They are interested in campaigning on interdisciplinary issues. I'm a past chair of the association, and they are part of a multidisciplinary alliance that has quite a lot of effective contacts and campaigning on interdisciplinary policy issues.
Yeah.
And they do quite a lot of work with government departments on these sorts of areas.
I'm wondering whether one can already now identify achievable strategic goals that we want to achieve through the dissemination. Well, so I can see that in terms of provision of counselling services, interventions, you could, you know, one could look at this set of findings, one could look at what's included in those interventions, and think it wouldn't be a stretch to add this in, you know, and it might have a benefit. But I'm wondering whether in policy terms, last time I talked to the Dartington trustees, one idea was, well, maybe should, you know, one of our key protective factors was co-parent support. Should there be, should we be encouraging employers to give a week's off, you know, a week's time off if your partner is severely depressed? You know, that would be, you know, it would cost business, but it would actually, for example, potentially have a major impact in terms of protective impact.
I think you have to demonstrate that it had a demonstrable impact in terms of financial benefit, economic
yes.
To get anywhere.
Where are you seeking research funding from? Which organisation are you looking at?
At the moment, MRC. So the study was supported by I should have put up. I didn't quite get to the end of my talk, and I feel very naughty because I didn't put this slide up. So this is just a list of all the different people who've helped with the study and who've helped fund the study as well. So the initial funding was from the Sir Charles Thorne Charitable Trust, which is a medical charity. And usually what they, you know, they'll give money and they'll expect you to come up with a cure for blindness or something. And, you know, the people, I remember Anita and Gordon went to talk to them about the progress on this study. And someone literally had cured blindness in dogs, you know, as a particular form of blindness. And they had to stand up and say, right. And they expected a practical impact of this study. So the initial study was set up very much with clinical objectives in mind from a medical perspective. But you can see from the way that I've talked about it, it's had a much broader significance potentially of finding. And then so additional funding that we're seeking at the moment is from the MRC for a further follow-up.
Have you looked overseas at all, the rest of Europe, for example?
For European funding?
For European funding. Are there other groups working within a sort of an area that would be complementary to you?
That's a good point. There are other groups. I'm aware of ones in the States, but not in not similar studies in Europe.
The Nuffield Foundation trustees have connections to researchers because they were inviting research from overseas, certainly up until very recently.
Okay.
And certainly people at Dartington are very connected and linked in to particularly the Netherlands, isn't it? But a whole group who are working on risk and protective factors in terms of communities, not particularly in terms of mental health, but who might well be overlapped and they're very welcome.
I mean, I think there are all sorts of links that we could make. I think one of the important links that we've tried to make internally, but also externally, a lot of the work in our department is based around collaboration with the genetics consortium, where all of the work has to happen by collaboration. There's no point having your own study. In the GWAS, you've got 30,000 people, 30 cases, 30,000 controls. But really what strikes me is, in the adult disorders, whether it's a GWAS or bipolar disorder, you could have a very interesting study of where you look at family members, where you look at children of adults with schizophrenia, of adults with depression, where you sample potentially from those big genetic consortiums, where you've got that infrastructure in place already, that collaboration. But I think that those are different questions and potentially research questions.
There is the only life course cohort study I know in continental Europe is in Germany, and the guy to contact is Professor Friedrich Lösel. There's none in Holland. I mean, they do a lot of stuff on risk factors, but they don't have these life course cohorts, which we've got here. And you're right, the Americans have too.
I mean,
and there's New Zealand as well, isn't there? The Dunedin.
Yes, Dunedin and Christchurch. So Gordon Harold is now one of the main. He's involved closely with the Christchurch study, so we'll be looking at
that. All of those are in the English language, and that's why everybody who does work in this area in the English language knows about those other cohort studies.
Yeah.
But the one they don't know about is the German one very often.
Okay.
Because, of course, their findings are all published in German.
Friedrich Lösel.
So Friedrich Lösel, L-O with an umlaut, S-E-L.